All right, thank you all very much for coming this evening, and thank you for your patience as we kind of get everything set up. It's always awesome whenever you kind of kick off a new program. You gotta work all the pieces together and get everything moving. My name is Matt Bullish. I work here at the Film Society of Lincoln Center. I help manage our Convergence program, which is our program that centers on immersive media, transmedia, immersive storytelling, video games, the intersection of all the arts coming together. We try to have it here. Usually an event every week, and you can find all of our information about Convergence, about upcoming events, about some of our big stuff, our small stuff, whatever, on filmlink.com. That's our website. You can also check out our printed calendar, which is kind of floating around all over the lobby and whatever else. I have some more down here. If you're interested afterwards, you can come by and grab it. We couldn't be more excited to be partnering with Killscreen Media for this amazing event. I don't want to take too much time talking about how great we think it is. But we do. We're very excited. And I guess I will just introduce Jamin Warren, who is a founder and of Killscreen, and also going to be moderating tonight. So again, thank you for coming to the Film Society. Thank you for checking us out. And have a very good time tonight. Thanks a lot.
Hello, how are you all doing today? thanks for coming out in the rain, really appreciate it. So my name's Jamin Warren. I run a video game arts and culture company called Killscreen. We're dedicated to the intersection between games, culture, and the arts. A couple months ago, we linked up with Matt and we did some programming for them at the New York Film Festival. One of the things that was really important for us at Killscreen was figuring out where are the places where games meet other things that are ultimately not games. Although, I guess in theory, maybe all things are games, but that's probably a conversation best saved for a separate time.
In grad school.
Yeah, exactly. So we leapt at the opportunity that we could, be at a place like Lincoln Center and collaborating with the Film Society. And so this is the first time we've ever done this. So we've sort of tentatively called the series, we've called it Killscreen Dialogues. We did something similar with artists at the New Museum last year, but it seemed like film was a good place to go. Thank you very much for coming out. We really certainly appreciate it. So for our first one, we're very, very happy to have Kellee Santiago. Formerly of That Game Company, and I apologize, we have kind of a complicated technical setup, so there will be a couple like pauses as we sort of bend our wills to the largest plasma screen on the East Coast. so please bear with us, we'll be jumping around and switching cables and whatnot. So I'll start with Kelle. Kelle and I first connected a couple years ago. I was a reporter at the Wall Street Journal, and I was really interested in, I guess, what was then sort of the new burgeoning independent game movement. And I saw a lot of similarities between some of the work that Kelle was doing and some of the work that some of the directors of the new Hollywood movement of the late 50s, 60s, and 70s were doing in terms of figuring out ways to use resources from larger entities to kind of pursue these really experimental creative visions. But I can let Kelle give her own introduction. Why don't you, probably a good place to start is, like, how did you get into games?
Yeah, so I think, is this microphone on? I don't know, but, okay, cool. Thank you. my path to games was kind of winding. I actually went to NYU, to the Chiss School of the Arts in theater. I grew up in Richmond, Virginia, and so, as my mom hates to hear, but the main goal was to move out of Richmond, Virginia and move to New York, and I wasn't quite sure. But I'd been in performing arts and music, and I was definitely gravitating towards that, and I lived in New York for a couple years after that, working in theater, sort of, again, gravitating towards managing and producing, and I really liked working on original works as opposed to remountings of old plays. And more of that stuff was incorporating interactive media and digital media, and I had grown up with a computer in my house, and I was comfortable with it, and so I started becoming more and more like the de facto person in charge of digital elements. And that's what brought me to the University of Southern California, the Interactive Media Program, which is in their School of Cinematic Arts, because it you didn't have to have a specific like math or computer science background to get into it. And I thought I would focus on interactive media and digital media and performance and sort of make that my career. But in the second semester, I took a course in game design, and that just really shifted my path ever since then. I just became really inspired. The course was actually sort of couching game design in more of the history of game design throughout human history, so predating digital media. And I think just starting from that context, it was already really inspiring to sort of think about all the subjects that video games had yet to touch upon, even though those subjects that we had sort of already as humans been discovering through play and through interactive entertainment. And so that was also where I met Genova Chen, and we worked on a student project with a number of other students called Cloud, which was sort of an excuse to really apply all of the design theory that we had been learning about trying to create games from a point of an emotional perspective of saying, what's the emotional experience we want the audience to get? What do we want to communicate? And then designing from there. And that's what, you know, long story short, and we may touch upon more of these points through this evening, that what led to the founding of That Game Company.
Often in the past when I've interviewed game designers and I ask them what their favorite forms of media are, more often than not, it's other video games. And or you ask them, you know, what their sources, what their references are, and it's kind of like Lord of the Rings or, you know, Arthur Clarke or Ray Bradbury. And I was wondering, how do you feel like an interdisciplinary background helped you or shaped your understanding of what games are or what they could be?
Yeah, definitely. And I think in a very tangible way, when Genova and I were going through the USC program, it was just the second year of the program. And so there weren't a lot of core interactive or game design classes that students get to enjoy today. But we instead took a lot of sort of fundamental cinema television courses of film production. We took an introduction to screenwriting, a fundamentals of animation. And all of those courses directly influenced the process that we both took into then our commercial game development.
Right, right. Was there, you know, you also had a background in experimental theater, is that right?
Yes.
What is that, yeah. What does that mean exactly?
What? That's another grad course conversation. Well, for me, one of the fundamental tenets, in a way, is similar to the approach we learned at USC to game design, which is sort of coming upon a theme or a subject that you want to create a performance around, and then sort of workshopping that in a collaboration with all the participants to get to that final experience.
Right, yeah. And that would be juxtaposed with, I guess what about it? I was told to
you're
use that in case I had any problems. I did not think it would cause any problems. I guess probably not to delve into it too much, but is there a particular director that you feel like is emblematic or one that you really loved when you were kind of in that scene that inspired you to kind of be in that world?
In theater direction?
Yeah.
Gosh, that's a good question that I don't get a lot. Now I have to like go back to there. I really am inspired by anyone that has a very unique voice and specific voice, and I love seeing when that final experience is, in my sense, you know, when my interpretation of it is sort of uncompromised and. So I just remember one of the first sort of New York theater experiences that were in that line was seeing a show at BAM that was a like rock opera that reminded me a lot of David Lynch, actually, and sort of being very expansive time and taking these I know, extreme perspectives.
Yeah. Right. They've been having these ads run in the New York City subway where people are, I don't know, in the kitchen or doing their taxes or, and just like, you know, BAM's thing is like that these memories of, experiences or things that they've seen in theater kind of come to life. I don't know. Does that, I don't know if that ever happens to you. I guess there are no subways. There is a subway in LA.
There is. I live off of stop. I do take it.
now Genova, Genova Chen is your partner and he couldn't be here with us. He's the creative director for TGC. Two questions. How did you initially meet Genova? And then why did you make the decision to work with another person, particularly on something creative is a big one. Why did you decide him as opposed to some of the other classmates?
Yeah, I mean, I met Genova, we were in a class of 9 people, and so we met, you know, the first day and worked on some projects together throughout that time. But when we worked on Cloud, and I actually came into Cloud towards the end of the development cycle to sort of help with production and sort of finishing it and getting it to the festivals and the website. And
so
that kind of
Cloud,
stuff.
So I guess for those who don't know, would be...
The game? What is the game?
Yeah.
So Cloud is a game. Our goal was to make a game that made you feel like you were a child daydreaming looking at the clouds, because we felt like that was an experience that anyone could relate to no matter where they were from or how old they were, and most importantly, their gamer or non-gamer status. We were really interested in breaking through that. And in the game, you play as this boy who's trapped in a hospital and daydreams he can fly through the clouds. And it's a really simple game, and you sort of, by the time we were finished it, it was like, it didn't hit all the grand, you know, goals that we had for it. It was sort of like, we need to, you know, just make an example of what this kind of experience would be like. And so you move around and you collect clouds and you can make shapes and interact with other clouds and make rainstorms. And while we were finishing it, it was underneath this grant that had initially come through Electronic Arts when they gave a grant to the program. And so there was this sort of neat tie-in to be able to then create this pitch, and we were pitching it to EA as what it would be in like a full-blown commercial title, and we just were really taking this as an opportunity to practice our pitching techniques. But as we were going through that process, you know, it asks you whenever you're sort of codifying your ideas, it really asks you to articulate them and think about them. And as we were having these discussions, we just realized more and more that we were very much on the same page about what we wanted to do. And we really enjoyed working with one another. And that was something for both of us that we had never really felt before.
Right.
Right.
Well, I think that's a good seg to talk a little bit about the slide I guess we had up earlier.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
You'd be better explaining at this than I would. But I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how experience and emotion played into your game design philosophy. That seems to be a really strong theme for students who graduated from USC's game design program.
Yeah, and so the first commercial title we actually made was this game Flow, which was based on Genova's thesis project. But Flower was really our first project as a company from beginning to end. So really thinking about what is this process going to be from the ground up. And so Jamie and I thought this would be a good reference point to start from. Here we have this idea of, you can see the three-act structure, right, which was taken from our screenwriting course, and how we wanted to take the players through this emotional journey to create a moment of catharsis, which, if you're familiar with our end journey, it's there's that, I think it's an emotion that Genova really enjoys capturing. So how do you get the player to go through that in a game experience?
That seems like a lot of pressure, I guess. He's like, no, you're going to end with catharsis, right?
Right.
Like, if you don't end with catharsis, you've played the game incorrectly.
It's a good play testing goal.
Right.
Did you have a cathartic moment?
Right.
And so that's what, just going back to the beginning of this document, I think we start with a target. And you can see here, I actually didn't even remember until I was pulling this up earlier that we referenced the hero's journey as well in this. So I think it was a theme that was sort of flowing underneath the surface for a while leading up to Journey, which was very much explicitly about taking the hero's journey into a game.
What we're looking at right now, this is the game design document, which might be helpful to explain what that is for.
Yeah, sure. So show of hands, who is familiar with game development process? Okay, cool. Then I'll get into it just so people aren't bored.
You should leave this talk being fully prepared to make your first
to make a first game.
Your PlayStation game.
So in making a game, you want to get money to fund your game. So we were in a 3-game deal with Sony Santa Monica to develop 3 titles for PlayStation Network. And what that translated to was a project by project. So they, at the beginning of a project, we would come to them with this idea and a general sketch of what the budget and the timeline was going to be, you know, and so then we could have that discussion around whether they wanted to do the specific game we were talking about. For the process, as I believe it's best done in games, is to sort of start with a target that's kind of wide and explore the experience in your visuals, audio, and interaction. And how you're exploring them is by building up prototypes in which people can come in, and we would usually start with friends, other game designers, come in and play and give feedback on. And then we iterate and iterate and iterate until we're at that point where we think, okay, this is now capturing that experience that we were going for. And as we're going through this iterative process, we also are kind of refining and narrowing that target down as well. So we start with this idea of a catharsis, of sort of a story of an everyman, so that it's not like an epic journey as we see in traditional video games like God of War, but that we still have, there's still the hero's journey and sort of the small day-to-day moments of our lives. And the other launch point that we were approaching Flower from was the inspiration of capturing the feeling of being in a giant field of flowers. Genova specifically had this experience coming to California from Shanghai, China, where he grew up, and experiencing, especially driving from Los Angeles to San Francisco, you can recognize some of that scenery in the final game that we developed. He just loved seeing these rolling expanses of nature and wanted to try and share that with his friends back home, but pictures weren't capturing it and movies weren't capturing it, and so we thought, well, could we make a game that captured that feeling? And initially, that was also this feeling of, like, giving love to other people, so that we'd have this feel-good experience, but giving love turned out to be way too abstract and nebulous to make a game about, so we weren't successful in that, and so it shifted more the feeling of being in a field of flowers, and that it would be a feel-good experience.
So you brought an early prototype of a flower that you can show.
Okay.
Which will be a good, I think it'll be a good juxtaposition.
Yeah, so this is one of, so when we're prototyping, we kind of prototype in whatever medium is most accessible to us at that time. We've done stuff, and in Flower we used processing, we used Flash, and we also used XNA, which I'm going to pull up one of our later XNA demos, which sort of show a step in the process that's somewhat getting close to what the final experience is, but still has a lot of concepts that are quite far. So you start, there was always this idea of the house, which you'll see in the game in a moment, and that there's these flowers on a windowsill, and that you're sort of escaping the house into the field of flowers. So I don't know if you can see it very well. Unfortunately, I can't make it very big.
I love that the size of the screen, just that little window, is larger than my television.
Yeah, <don't>, right.
Like, I would kill to have a TV that large in my room.
I know, and here it feels so small. I'm like, meh. And you can see also we're already experimenting with the controls. So yeah, I'll pump this up. And we have some of the music and sound effects still to play. We usually have art and music sort of cranking much earlier than on most games. So we're flying through this field of flowers, and as I go through, notes are gonna play, but they sound very game designy.
Did you guys already have, well, flowers, I guess that was already figured out, but
We knew there was going to be a field of flowers. And so, and it's a fair point, because simultaneous to this, we have the engineers and artists working on the PlayStation 3 to actually develop the environment out, while our designers were working on X and A to sort of figure out what these, what were you going to do in this field of flowers once we got it. And so what's happening here is I'm going through and collecting various petals. And then the idea here, and I'm actually not quite sure, it is somewhat in this prototype, is that these different petals have different actions you can do. So some will give you a boost, and some will help you like daisy chain or auto aim for you. And so it's very, what we say is very gamey. But again, having that emotion from the start, knowing that we're aiming for the feeling of being in a giant field of flowers, when people were playtesting this and getting really frustrated, they were not sounding so much like they were in a giant field of flowers. And so that was, we knew it wasn't gonna work. And then what would happen is, I don't think I can do it here, but so you could land and then grow a new flower that would give you like new abilities. Yeah,
it's very cool. At no point you had considered adding, Kratos from God of War. There was no pressure from Sony at any point to add add additional characters from successful Sony franchises.
No. I mean, I think thankfully, when you're a small developer, and especially you were still pretty early in the life cycle of PlayStation Network here, kind of flew under the radar for the most part. So I'm sure there are people that thought we were just totally crazy and like this game was just gonna be ridiculous,
and you just said catharsis and then just walked out. I'm sure. Why don't we just before we get into some of what the games actually look like, why don't we take a look at a couple of the early Journey screens, and you give a quick recap of what the inspiration was for Journey before we actually show it.
Sure. So for Journey, as with Flower, the inspiration, I mean, I think with any project, inspiration sort of comes from a number of different sources that kind of start congealing at the same time. So with Journey, there were the ideas were, we knew we wanted to make an online game because neither Flow or Flower were that. And our goal as a company was to make games that were different than other games that had been previously, different emotions that had been previously explored in the video game space. So when we think of online console title, usually think of highly competitive, violent, and like 13-year-old boys yelling at you. And we wanted to make an online game that left you with a renewed sense of faith in humanity. We thought that would be a really big
goal. You guys really, you like swing for the fences on every, it's like, what could we, some people, they just were like, I just want to make another racing game. And you guys are like,
I was always really happy with that everyone, regardless of our difference of opinions on, many different things, we all agreed that, as long as we were doing it, we're going to do stuff that, we couldn't do any other time.
Right. So you'll make the first video game that put someone on Mars, right? Like right, literally put a human being on Mars.
That's a great idea. Let me get that down. And then, so we had that. There's the hero's journey, which was kind of came apart, I think, of Genova's trajectory in wanting to create experiences that anyone could relate to, and that the monomyth, right, as defined by Joseph Campbell, is everyone here kind of familiar with that in some level?
We're going to presume
on the film, the Lincoln Center Film Society.
Well, we can go. Let's go there.
But the basic structure of a story, and the myths that have reoccurred time and time again throughout all of human history, sort of have this similar structure of a story, and applying that to a video game, and just generally this idea of being on a journey, and that sharing the journey in and of itself was a meaningful experience to have with someone else. Like just being in a different place and seeing it with someone. And that would be the mechanic in a way. So
it's like a family vacation, I guess.
Yeah. Or like what we kept talking about was that feeling when you're on a hike and you encounter that other hiker, and then you sort of are, you always feel like this immediate connection with this other stranger. Yeah.
But I mean, I guess when in my one experience on the Appalachian Trail, encountering another hiker, there is that kind of moment, like, who is this person?
The wary.
Yeah, sort of the wary, like, if something happens, they'll never find me. But I suppose that's the, I mean, these are games after all. And so I suppose I'm curious, you made some decisions to,
sure,
to take away people's ability to have negative hiker experiences.
Yeah. Yeah. And actually I can go, I can go kind of back into, so this is just some slides from like the ideas around it and how to create,
if you have
that
early,
Game Company Online experience.
Yeah. If you have early stuff, 'cause we're going to show the game in a minute. Is there another,
so, Those were just early collaborative prototypes. We had, for a long time, we were just prototyping in Flash, creating an online network and like testing all the stuff out. Because there's an element where you sort of are also prototyping like your own capability as a team and like how long things are going to take and stuff like that. And so we had these circles, and you could encounter towers that you would be able to avoid enemies, and you had trails that you would make. And so that would help, you could help other people, and you could also like, move on their trails. And so, yeah, I mean, these are, there's one with like, a little, and it, there's like a bad guy in it, but you can't attack them, you have no weapons, you can only hide from them, or, you know, help one another to climb up towers was the idea.
I think part of what's fascinating, and for people who don't get to see games, I think we, you know, you think about when a director shows like early cuts or something like that, those usually echo what, you know, what the film ultimately might look like. And one of the things I think that's amazing about game design is that, you know, as game designers, you're working out a specific idea or a mechanic, and it doesn't look anything like what the final product ultimately like be. It's not even like, you know, if you look at, you know, sketches or something like that for an illustrator, I find that's one of the most interesting pieces of game design, is that this idea that you're just studying human interaction, and then what the final form ultimately is totally different from where you started.
Yeah, and it's funny too, because it's through this process, right, of a third party evaluating. The process of playtesting is something I love so much about games, because there's this person or people outside of you that are then telling you whether you're giving them the experience you intend or not. And so it also adds this element of like looking through old prototypes, which we do at the end of our projects, and you're just like, God, what were we thinking? Like, of course, that was so awful. These are actually early PlayStation 3 prototypes. So you actually have the characters in the game. There was this idea of like giving this formal greeting to another person, which didn't work.
Why didn't that work? What was the greeting?
Was
it like?
Well, so that we tried a couple of different things of like of a bow, and like you showed your symbol, or like your cloth would interact with one another, but it was just kind of this forced moment. It didn't feel very intrinsic or organic to the experience.
And you know,
which was
I think
one of the goals.
For people in New York, it's totally customary to like, not greet people.
Oh, right.
I don't like, see a lot of bowing. There's plenty of showing your cloth, so to speak. We're gonna make a jump here and talk a little bit about openings, but I'm gonna bring another guest to the stage. His name is Brian Clark, and I will let him give his own introduction while I unplug some things.
Oh, we're gonna cover up the tech, huh?
Yeah, that's what's gonna happen right now.
Hey guys, I'm Brian Clark. I run a company called GMD Studios. So I come from both an interactive art and a traditional indie filmmaking background, but I think of myself as an experienced designer. So I work in different medias at different times, sometimes in the real world, sometimes in the digital world. So the stuff that you were talking about is exactly the way we think about things like alternate reality games or physical experiences. So I wonder, do you think you brought part of that from your theater background to the USC program? Because I know they talk about it from like a screenwriting point of view.
Yeah.
But you're literally talking about, I'm not hearing you use the classic words of game design like agency.
Mm-hmm.
I'm hearing you talk about experiences.
Yeah. I mean, I think the most we have is there's still feedback loops, which is pretty classic game term of what's the reward you're giving the player. And I think that's something where people don't associate that with our experiences, but it's because my take on it is that it should be intrinsic to the experience itself. So,
So let's talk about openings. They say in film that the most important thing you see is, or the two most important things you see are the first thing and the last thing, and mm-hmm. that directors spend a lot of time making sure that there's a lot of meaning embedded into those. So we thought it would be good, in early talks with Kelle, that was something she had mentioned that had been a real inspiration. We unfortunately do not have the movie Hot Fuzz, but maybe Kelle could talk a little bit about the movie Hot Fuzz and how somehow a British satirical crime drama comedy thing inspired the meditative zen that is Flower.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, starting with Flower, Genova and I both have been thinking about how it's where we started the process of thinking in all our games of how we were going to bring players into our mind space. Because, like, already this is different than, you can even see some of the graphics below Flower on the cross media bar, and you have, like, explosions and, like, cartoons moving, and, thinking that either someone's booting up their PlayStation 3 in expectation of a certain type of experience, or they have just come from this other experience. So how do you shift them and get them to let go of notions like competition, or let go of some of those expectations that they may have just coming to a video game in the first place? And so taking that idea of the first moment and really creating a palate cleanser with it, and in a way shocking them out of what it is they were doing before and bringing them into the experience we want them to have. And at that time, we were thinking about all this. I just remembered when we were talking that Hot Fuzz was out in theaters, and we both, Genova and I, had seen it independent of one another, but then we're like, they totally do that because there's this first opening sequence and there's like cool music playing and he's going through his job, but it sets up all of the sort of core qualities of the movie you're about to experience, taking you out of all the trailers you've just seen or the day you've just had, and like putting yourself into more of like a wacky, whatever, Hot Fuzz state of mind.
Right. Right. So I mean, I guess the converse would be if you're a yoga teacher, then, Gears mm-hmm. of War would be an appropriate palate cleanser mm-hmm. for you, right?
Mix it up.
Let's mix it up. Kent, why don't we get started? Turn on the lights. Brian was asking about this earlier, what the potential risk of epilepsy or seizure was playing Flower, because there's a warning ahead of time. Or is that just standard?
Yeah, that's just standard. Although there are some games that apparently
have you could have risk of catharsis, though. That might happen. I'm really gonna keep coming back to
comedy is all repetition.
Risk of catharsis.
Oh, so I was gonna ask you about this. So this first, most games come with booklets and explanations. How difficult was it to simplify the gameplay into three? Was that a difficult design decision for you?
The menu as a whole in Flower was developed over the course of the entire
game, the pink one.
2 years. Wait, do you want to start at the beginning in cinematic? Yeah. Then the yellow one.
Oh, yeah. The yellow one. Right. Sorry. The woman who made the game. Sorry about that.
I'm pretty sure. So if you just zoom in on it. Yeah. Which the menu then acts as like a small tutorial into the controls.
Now, is this computer generated imagery or?
These are paintings.
Who did the paintings for you?
It was a combination of a couple artists. We had Thomas Yamaoka, who did all the menus. And then refined these paintings that were started by Hao Sui, who was the lead artist on the game.
And I think we need to talk loudly because...
Oh, okay.
Oh, can you turn our mics up just a little bit? Thank you. Now, that city, was that based on a particular city? The
no.
city that we sh- that the dark that dark city.
No. Okay. No particular city.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm sensing some like East Coast, West Coast. Like West Coast inspires flowers and
East Coast is dark
yeah,
and dreary.
I don't know if you've ridden the G train after dark, that may be what you feel like.
Well, and so the course of the entire game is you basically journey back into the city. That idea of giving love as the sort of the X statement or the theme of the game became refined into an idea of finding harmony and balance, because we found that as we were building out these environments that you would feel kind of lonely after a while in being them. You kind of miss the element of the city. And so we wanted to play around with that idea of sort of that you need both together.
So the city's not all bad.
Exactly. City's not all bad. Nature's not all good.
Did you read any Wendell Berry when you were, are you familiar with him?
No.
He's a poet. He's not very fond of the city. one note, so that first.
Koyaanisqatsi, a lot
right?
of Koyaanisqatsi.
That first sequence, I was going to ask about the first thing that you see is kind of like this big open field. Did you guys experiment with other things that you see, or like how do you draw the player's eye so they know exactly what they're doing from the moment when they get started?
Well, they're stuck to a flower when
right.
they start. That was part of it. I mean, it was like free flowing initially. So you make decisions to help guide the player into the experience we want them to have. You know, we really, all of the experiences that we made for PlayStation Network are really the emphasis are on exploration and discovery. So we want it to feel like the player's invited. You can see, right, there's no timer, there's no hit points or, you know, life meter.
But there were trophies, right? There are trophies.
There are trophies required by.
Was that a source of contention for you guys in terms of, you know, that is something you're sort of collecting or that's a form of competition, I guess?
Yeah, I mean, it's not really, like, we try to make the trophies in line with the games that we made. I don't know that it's something we would have chosen to do, but at the same time, I think there are players who really value it, so it provides them value. And just hopefully there's enough to do where players who aren't into that don't feel pressure necessarily to collect trophies. If they don't want to, they can do other things.
Right. That makes a lot of sense. The one of the questions I had was about the sort of the theme of reclamation of nature. You kind of have these fallow, you know, air sections. And is there metaphorical meaning in that? Or is that just like you thought that would be an interesting thing for players to do?
Say that again.
Oh, I'm just wondering, do you feel like, I mean, that's kind of the mission of the players to sort of recapture the beauty of nature.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering, was that something that you guys initially started with in terms of having the fallow leaves of grass and sort of that's a theme in the game that brown stuff becomes green again?
Yeah, it was a concept that we worked on from pretty early on. It's the feeling of, well, wanting to make a feel-good experience and this idea of having an impact on the environment of the game.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, the world literally changes with your...
with your presence.
Right. Which seems like, so this is a question, this would be a question. You know, most games are traditionally about, you know, power and dominance, but there does seem to be some... You are kind of giving players this kind of like power over nature, though.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I mean, that's one of those things, right? Like people comment, there are no points in flower, right? But as you are collecting these flower petals, and so the reward, instead of a number ticker that you're counting up and up, is that your swarm becomes more beautiful. You have the ability to travel faster the more petals you collect.
Do you think that's inherent in games? Do you think
and the music changes as you collect as well.
I was just going to ask you about that. Like, talk to me about the music is adapting to the player's actions.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, what is that like having to design soundtrack elements that can be combined together based upon player action?
I think that's where the magic of a great video game score is. And there are more composers now who are coming into that. For Flower, we worked with Vincent Diamante, and on Journey, we worked with Austin Winery, who are both exceptional composers in that way specifically, which is why we like working with them.
Right, absolutely. Okay, we are going to move on, look at something else in a second. Give me one moment to make a connection. Hold on.
All right.
I know we need music for my transition. So we're going to move on to Journey in terms of openings. Now, you were inspired by a film produced by Spike Jonze and David Lynch. I was wondering if you could talk about how... Actually, let's watch the clip first.
And yeah. Then,
so this was inspiration for the beginning of Journey.
Yeah.
And there's my mouth.
Super quiet. Mm-hmm.
It's loud or quiet now.
I think there's supposed to be, no?
I think it kicks out of that.
Oh. Yeah, I love the scene because it's just a moment that's kind of referenced in the rest of the movie. I mean, it's what leads to the reason the main character is in the hospital. But other than that, there's no story context. It's really here to get you into the frame of mind you need to be to watch the rest of the movie. It has sort of every storytelling element and like theme you're about to go through, but without explicitly telling you that. So the next day I came into the office and made everyone watch it. And then we asked our art director, Matt Nava, and composer Austin Winery to create an intro to Journey. Because at that point we didn't have one, and so in a way it was sort of skewing playtesting feedback because you didn't have that moment to get the player into the state of mind.
We're going to switch.
So we'll switch over and
we're going to switch over. Switch over the journey. Amazing. Kent, start a new journey.
Yeah.
You are sure.
Yes. So that sequence makes a little more sense once you've finished your first journey to the mountaintop. And again, with the emphasis of this experience being on exploration and discovery, you wanted that moment where you know, this is the first moment of the player's experience. You just wake up in the desert.
Now, when you were watching people play, were they ever confused or disoriented?
Yeah, I mean, there was a lot of stuff we learned over the course of Flower in just creating terrain and, you know, placing objects in the world to sort of hint towards or guide the player towards their destination. Here's a very obvious one that we're about to do. So you're going to the mountaintop. that's it. And then there was more over, there's a lot, you know, more of the course of journey. I think spatial design and architecture are really skills that we're seeing more and more come into the video game world, but not nearly enough, in my opinion, I think.
In terms of controlling people.
In terms of creating space in which they can feel like they are open to explore without getting lost in. I really love games in which, I actually think probably Red Dead Redemption was the best large game at doing this, where you could actually remember where you were based on landmarks and, you know, scenery.
So are you someone who remembers, like, when you get off this? I know you have a subway in Los Angeles, as we previously discussed, that you know exactly where you are? Do you feel like this type of game privileges someone who has that kind of spatial?
I don't think so, no.
Is that a concern that you ever have in terms of you know, making sure players know exactly?
Yeah, I mean, you don't want them lost or frustrated unless that's what you want them to feel. But right. For the most part, we don't
want
them to
feel. Like going to IKEA, for example. Which is
yeah, right, exactly. You know, just like IKEA and other versus other stores, there are techniques you can use to help your audience feel calm. And it's interesting because that's something we find happens a lot with new players. The most is they expect a really hostile environment in a video game, just in general, and so they'll sort of panic the most initially.
Right.
Over, what am I supposed to do? Where am I supposed to go? And it's like, really, just go. You know, you'll figure it out. I promise. And sometimes also for us watching them playtest, there are things in the game where, you know, most players would take 3 minutes to figure it out. And watching it, those 3 minutes are total agony. But then you think later, well, 3 minutes, like, that's okay. You
so
know,
that seems to be a tension inherent with game design, right, where you create this system and this world, and then you have to watch people do things in a way that you would have never intended them to
right.
do. Is that frustrating at all?
Oh yeah, it's completely frustrating to watch. You have to keep in mind, and at least I like to, is that that's also the magic of making games as opposed to any other medium. And sometimes players should be players. You know, there are statues you can stand on top of their heads and stuff. You know, it's not the like sexiest thing in the world, but some players really love doing that. They love being able to exploit the systems, and like that's okay too.
Sure. But
so I'm going to ask you, what's the most amazing unexpected thing that you've seen players do with one of your games? Because I look at things these days, like, to me, one of the really exciting things about games is the way they're becoming platforms. Mm-hmm. The way things like Machinima like give another generation of artists like an opening to use things that mm-hmm. were not designed for storytelling.
Right.
And yet suddenly they find a way to use it. Where have there been similar things with Flower or Journey?
I'm trying to think. I mean, I feel like the elements of Flower and Journey are so simple that it's hard to deviate too much. And I mean, they're pretty contained experiences, so we do and we play test them pretty rigorously.
But I mean, like cosplay. Have you seen anyone at GDC dressed up like the guy
yeah.
from Journey?
No, I met a young woman at the Smithsonian exhibit opening who was dressed as a Journey character, and that was totally awesome. Actually, so in that way, the craziest thing is the people getting tattoos, which
Is that, that's like, I mean, as a game designer, I guess that's like you win, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like, I can't believe I made something that someone wants permanently etched on their body, yeah. You know? Like
that. Because none of you have Journey tattoos.
No, not that I'm aware of.
It's very cathartic if you get one.
Right.
Maybe Genoa's collecting them in like a private place. He's not telling anyone about.
Right, right. So this is actually a good moment to talk about story. You know, traditionally, you know, there are a lot of games that have sort of really straightforward stories. And with Journey, it's much more oblique. Did you guys have like a fully written out, like, is there a script that went with Journey in terms of this is the actual narrative in the world?
Yeah, there are many of them. Like everything else, it was iterated over time. This whole room actually in early versions of the game was more of a spacecraft in the middle, and the idea was that this was sort of the room that showcased the pinnacle of this civilization that you had been exploring that was now in ruins, and so there's sort of a you could see history of studying astronomy and like sciences, and but it just wasn't fitting with the rest of the experience in a way. As we were playtesting it, it just sort of felt like this moment where it was too sci-fi, I guess, for lack of a better word, and also the story was kind of shifting more towards this spiritual, well, it always been sort of a spiritual journey, and sort of this moment and where it was placed within the world of the game, it felt like it needed to be more of a moment that emphasized that spiritual story, right, and not the literal story of the history of the civilization.
Does the character have a name?
No.
What did you call it internally? Did you give it a name?
Well, you have to give everything a name in code. But you know, we try and never name anything or name any levels, so that way it's another way for play. It's open to interpretation by the players.
Did you have a nickname for the main character?
Yeah, the dude.
Dude.
I think that's what it's called in code. Like
just dude.
Yeah.
Right, exactly. No, is there a particular religion that you guys, that you all looked at in terms of, you know, for inspiration? Because people have often described Journey as being a spiritual type experience.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's very much the history of monomyth is like, it's a common story through many religions anyways. Here I think you're seeing a lot of inspiration from like Tibetan death rituals, with the stones and cloth, the flags that they have on their tombstones. And,
right.
Yeah.
Did you travel at all to, you know, for inspiration in terms of trying to find tapestries or anything like that?
We didn't go on explicit trips for tapestries, although our Matt Nava, the art director, realized when he went to his parents' house after we had finished the game that the sort of wall paintings that get revealed look just like the tapestry that it was in his bedroom growing up. Like he put it together at the end of the project. and his dad actually is an artist and had done, while we were starting Journey, this giant tapestry for USC that's in the library there. So
and then all these
inspirations,
all the runes. Now, is that an actual language that you developed, or where does, you know, or is it just random symbols?
The symbols are random symbols. Yeah, not a specific vocabulary as far as what, like the person shouting.
Right, absolutely. Okay, awesome. We are going to open up the floor for some questions.
Okay, I was hoping we'd get to the final story scene here.
Yes,
like,
let's
if you
do that.
Unlock it to the...
Play faster.
But yeah. Move!
Journey better.
Stop being so spiritual and meditative.
Yeah, stop. What are you doing? Thinking about the game? Goodness, that's terrible.
Yeah, because you have the sort of big story reveal before the final trek up the mountain.
Oh, so I was going to ask you, the mountaintop, again, is that like mythological language, or was that something that you guys were really inspired by an actual mountain, or, you know, where did that idea come in as a marker?
Not an actual mountain, but it was an idea, just like everything else, that sort of shifted over the course. Initially, it was going up a mountain, but that the final moment was sort of going through this cliff. The idea was this civilization had eventually built a wall around itself, which then led to its own demise, and that you were going to be able to like cut through the wall at the end. But it didn't work for technical and gameplay reasons. Like, it was just a odd visual, and it was hard to represent. And
now, what do you mean by by technical reasons? Because that seems to be that's something that happens. Okay.
So much pressure.
Now, by technical reasons, you mean like in terms of there were limitations on processing power? I mean, that seems to be a common thing with games, right, where there are actual limits in terms of what you can do.
Yeah. I mean, constructing a giant wall, that's like a huge asset for your game to hold.
Right. Right, absolutely. For the the character design, fabric is a really big piece of what you all did. Did you go through how many different versions of the main character did you go through before settling on?
Yeah.
Let's see. I would say we went through three discrete versions, although there were a lot of like tiny iterations along the way. The first one we had was very much like a Bedouin type character. You could see their legs and their arms. One of the reasons we got rid of the arms was because players then had an expectation around being able to climb rocks and do things that they could do in other games in which they had arms.
You give people an inch, they take a mile, right? Yeah.
So we went to more of like a bird-shaped character similar to this, but the proportions were sort of too cutesy. They were too small and petite, and we really wanted the character to sort of have a sense of ambiguity around gender or age or, you know, everything, where they're from, and so that you wouldn't have like this immediate specific association with the character. So and also, because we have a small team, we got to a maximum of 13 people on Journey. We never had more than one animator at a time. So like fully articulating animations with a human body was impossible for us to do. Right. So leaning on our cloth simulation system by making the character mainly a giant robe, it allowed for us to create a character that feels very realistic and tactile.
Right, absolutely. Does this illustration exist for you somewhere? I mean, in terms of, was this ever, this particular sequence, was this drawn out and then you added it later? Okay.
Yeah, Matt had a process of always sketching all these cinematics out beforehand.
Yeah, definitely some bird-like themes in Journey.
Such beautiful work.
Thank you. I mean, Matt was just amazing, and Austin Wintering and doing the music, and he really advocated for the live recording. So there's actually live musicians playing in that, which really, I think, does make a huge difference.
What was the other option?
Synthesize, which is what Flower uses. You can get pretty good synthesized sounds, which is why, I was kind of skeptical of what the difference would be with live recordings. And I think what really sealed it from early on is the first track Austin did was the theme song for the game that you heard at the beginning, and Tina Guo doing that cello solo. It's just so powerful. And I think took us a long way with Sony before they started asking questions about what we were doing.
Let's open it up for questions, because we're almost coming to a close. Is Kent, maybe go back to the first level for folks who have not yet played.
Spoiler.
I guess that's one of the nice things about a game with an explicit story is that, you know. I mean, do you feel like there are spoilers in Journey? Do you feel like that's possible?
Well, I do think that the end, as far as...
We don't need to talk about the end, but I'm just curious.
Yeah, like, no. I mean, when especially when it was like getting reviewed, right? And we want people's like first impressions to be right. I think the end moment when you traverse up the mountain and then you go into this last like sort of joyous flight, it doesn't feel as good when you're watching it as when you've played it. Like when you've actually trudged up that final mountain, you know, and gotten there. I think that does make a difference.
Right.
But I'm not too big on like surprises being leaked and all that stuff. I don't know.
Right. Do you have any questions for Kelle?
Yeah, you
got one on the end.
Yeah. Well, it's actually can be mostly a problem in that specific level that we just saw, because for the most part, in every other level, if someone's going way ahead of you, then they'll just be disconnected from you. And I think even in that level, if you go so far ahead, it'll just disconnect the other person. But the hope is that by the time you've gotten to that level, you've sort of gotten so much into a state of mind that you probably won't do that.
You have high hopes for humanity.
Well, I mean, it's like what I keep comparing it to is like you behave differently in a candlelit restaurant than you do in a McDonald's. There are ways in which we're influenced by the space that we're in, and I do think game designers have that ability, which I think many online game designers kind of took a cop-out previously. I was just sort of being like, oh, that's just the way gamers are. That's the way online gamers are. And it's like, well, no, because you're creating a hostile environment. Like, that's right. Of course, that's the way they're going to behave.
So giving someone tactical knives probably doesn't engender, you know, a lot of... Well, speaking of which, because I mean to ask you, why are there no weapons in Journey? I don't normally make I don't make suggestions, but I just from a fan.
What do you want to
I really
stab
wish.
In Journey?
Right,
exactly.
But it's a good question about like, can you annoy other players or?
Yeah, the biggest thing is that you can. You could, if you really wanted, grief them. Like, if you have a super... Because you can collect these white symbols around the world, which make your cloth longer. And the thing we would do to each other in the office is then you, like, try and wrap the other person in your cloth or just, like, put it in their face and, like... But yeah. It's, like, kind of funny, right?
Hate finds a way.
Yeah, if you really want to be that player, then I guess you could be that player.
Do we have any other questions? Here we go. We got one right here.
Yeah, I mean, actually, just to speak to that point, I mean, when I finished playing, you know, you see everybody's name at the end?
Yeah.
It's an interesting moment because everyone's alias is, like, kick-ass.
Right.
Super, like, immature, and, like, you're like, I can't believe I, like, almost love this person.
It's like the lights coming on at the end of prom or something like that.
Yeah.
Do you think it
Would I try? I don't know if it's something I'm necessarily inspired to do right now, at least because I think you, the beauty of languageless play is that you can engage with people you don't know. And in Journey, it is a global server, so you can be connected to a Japanese player. Whereas in other online experiences, even though they may not explicitly tell you to play with people from your own region, so many of them require coordination of action that you have to be on a team with people who speak your same language. So that's already cutting off a segment of the world that you're not playing with, and sort of not taking necessarily as much advantage of kind of the magic of the fact that it's online. But I think it's possible. I mean, I think there's still quite a bit of room for just craft in video game development. And you see writing and stories done like, you know, I think Uncharted is a good example of something that's really well written that can make a really big impact on the player's experience. So.
Well, and so I wanted to mention, you know, because some of the work I do falls into the category of alternate reality game.
Right.
Which does mix player agency with traditional narrative and does it in the real world. So you've got the same sort of situation where you've got people that have arrived from the internet to a physical location to interact with actors and accomplish something. And the chance for something to be derailed by a griefer is very, very high. But I think, to go back to you, it's actually experimental theater that gives you all the answers to that. It's things like theater of the oppressed. Mm. It's things like invisible theater. There's a lot of rules that come from the theater space about how you can, the word that theater would use is spect actor, how you use someone both as a spectator and an actor and get them to cross that fourth wall. Mm-hmm. And there are ways to build that into a structure that tend to be very positive and tend to reduce griefing. And I think that same kind of stuff can work in video games. Mm-hmm. When you're in the real world, you have no choice but to deal with a little bit more narrative because you don't have the same sort of perspective control that you would have in film and gaming. But so I think games can tell traditional narratives, and I think the gaming mechanics can help us as traditional narrativists tell stories in more meaningful ways because of that player agency, because they feel like they're invested in the emotions of the moment.
That's a really good point, and I think that's a good place to stop. Thank you all very much for coming to our first ever Kill Screen Dialogues. We'll be doing this every month. Everyone, let's give a warm hand to Brian and Kelle.
Hey, Kelle.
Thank you all very much. Thank you to the Film Society for letting us host this, and have a pleasant and cathartic evening.
That was great.